When it comes to small airplanes, Alaskans are unique. There are 6 times as many pilots per capita in Alaska than in the lower 48, and 12 times as many airplanes. The air taxi industry in Alaska has been described as the closest thing we've got to a mass transit system. On the other side of the coin, of course, is the fact that Alaskans have an unfortunate habit of wrecking their airplanes and sometimes killing themselves and their passengers at an alarming rate. In 1975, there were 212 small airplane crashes reported, resulting in 59 deaths. Last year, there were 334 crashes, an increase of 57%, and 79 deaths, up 1/3. The number of planes and pilots increased at a far slower rate during that same period, so it's clear that things are getting worse. On the national level, Alaska's 9,000 pilots, 1.25% of all the pilots in the U.S., were responsible for over 7% of the crashes in the country in 1976. And Alaska's air taxi industry has the worst record of all. Their 79 crashes last year represented 40% of all air taxi accidents in the country and 31% of the fatalities. Alaska Review decided to find out what's going on here.
A twin Beechcraft crashed this morning into the Anchorage Municipal Dump. The pilot, Bruce McRae, was shaken up but not seriously hurt. The plane, which crashed into the dump off the end of the International Airport's east-west runway, belongs to the Klondike Line. Damage to the plane, which was carrying snow machines to Bethel, was severe.
All I know is I looked out the corner of my eye when he was coming in over the fill, and that was it. You know, it just happened so quick that I didn't even see anything, other than him bouncing around until he finally stopped. And I came up, and he gave me the high sign that he was all right, and couldn't get these doors open, and then ran around the other side and kicked the emergency hatch open and got him out of there.
How was he?
Fine, just shaken up. Maybe in a state of shock, I don't know.
Was he the only guy on the plane?
The only guy. That was it. No fire, no nothing.
Got a happy ending to this one, huh?
The guy's lucky.
For pilot Bruce McRae, it was indeed a lucky crash. By itself, this incident was relatively minor. But in context statewide, this was only one of 334 small airplane crashes in Alaska in 1976. And those were just the ones that were reported. Where do Alaska's general aviation pilots make their mistakes? To find out, Alaska Review went flying with Jerry Olson on the right and Rick Schneider of Anchorage in their Super Cubs. While cameraman Mark Badger shot from Rick's plane, I talked to Jerry about the kinds of pilots he's run into and how they get themselves into trouble.
There's a kind of a pilot that buys an airplane to use for hunting and fishing, and he'll spend thousands of dollars just to get a couple more feet on takeoff or short field landing. It'd be like a fella buying a rally sports car and going out and using it, and he don't want to wreck it, but sometimes those things happen. And the same thing happens with that kind of a pilot that flies up here using an airplane like a Jeep. Another kind of pilot that probably considers more fatalities than anything else is the weekend pilot that doesn't do much flying during the year, and then when hunting season comes, he goes out and he tries to do what other pilots have been doing all year long, and those are the kind that kill you. As far as commercial operations go, well, there's several different adversaries there also. The places they're landing, the unorthodox runways that they've got, snow drifts in the wintertime that you can't see, and long distances between gas stops when you're on wheels, and if you have to make an alternate route, you run low on gasoline. You got these passes to go through, and sometimes you're committed because you can't go back because of the lack of fuel. And things like that that I think are probably a little different up here than down the States, and that's what causes the accidents.
Jerry, what do you look for when you're evaluating a landing site out in the bush like this?
Well, you got a lot of things to consider. If you're landing on the lakes, you got to figure the temperature and the overflow. This time of the year, particularly, we've had a lot of warm weather, and it's kind of marginal on some of these lakes yet. They haven't frozen very thick. You got to be sure, of course, you got enough distance to get in and get out again. When you're on skis, you haven't got any brakes.
According to a recent survey by the Federal Aviation Administration, pilot error is the biggest cause of small airplane crashes in Alaska. But the weather and the terrain are so rugged here that even though they can't be blamed directly on many accidents, indirectly they can. In Alaska, it's a lot easier to make a mistake in judgment, and the price can be a lot higher for that mistake than in the lower 48. Frank Malone is the head of the Alaskan Office of the National Transportation Safety Board. It's his job to figure out why an accident occurred and what can be done to prevent similar mishaps in the future.
We have the same problems I have in the lower 48, but except in the lower 48, there's excellent weather available, there's plenty of fuel available, there's a hard runway to land on just about every place you go. Off-airport landings in Alaska are very difficult at times, and the environmental conditions you're operating under. In the wintertime, a ski operation is probably the most rugged airplane operation there is as far as the equipment. And so we do have a great deal of accidents that occur that are off recognized landing places.
Everybody seems to agree that it's the weather that makes flying in Alaska especially tricky and sometimes dangerous. But Alaska's so big that the weather varies tremendously from one part of the state to the other. So Alaska Review decided to ask pilots in different parts of the state to tell us about weather in their particular region. First, southeast. Russ Swaim is owner of Weber Air Service in Ketchikan, a large and on the whole very safe operation.
It, southeast Alaska probably is one of the areas that is probably the hardest to fly and adapt to. Of any place in Alaska itself, because you have the mountainous areas, and the with that you get your very bad visibility, low ceilings, and poor visibility type situations, and high winds. And I think that this is one of the main factors involved in the air taxi business in southeast Alaska.
In the far north, pilots have a whole different set of weather problems. Alaska Review's Eric Ekholm talked to a number of pilots in the Kotzebue area and nearby villages.
The big thing here is just the cold temperatures, and if you're going down this time of year, be ready for it, and you'll have survival gear on board your airplane and this type of thing, which somebody coming up green from the States doesn't always have, and they don't know just exactly what they should be packing with them. This kind of weather that we're having right now is kind of unusual for this time of year up here. It's been beautiful.
What kind of gear do you take with you?
Well, heavy clothing is essential, warm clothes, parkas, packs on your feet, this type of thing. Mukluks are real good. Also, you should have a sleeping bag on board in case you do go down. Should have some survival rations on board. This dried food that they make for this, for backpacking, this type of thing, works real good because it's lightweight and easy to pack. And be familiar with the area so that you know just about where you're at if you do have to land someplace, and then don't get in a big hurry. And the big thing is just don't panic. Stop and think things out.
In Fairbanks, Air Service owner Paul Haggland told Alaska Review's Mark Badger,
most of them are hunting accidents. A lot of times I think people don't fly all the air. Then they try to go out and land on a 400-foot sandbar, and unfortunately they haven't flown and they're not sharp, and they have an accident. Well, hopefully any pilot will have a little common sense and judgment, and before taking off, say on a trip from Fairbanks to the bush, he would check with a flight service station on the aids available, navigational and whatever. Plus maybe talk with some of the local pilots. And I am a safety counselor for the FAA, and I'm always happy to give, any information and suggestions that I've picked up through the years in my flying career to these people. Basically, I think you can take a pilot from anywhere and he can fly up here, but he has to use just some good common sense and judgment.
And in Anchorage, we caught up to a well-known master guide from the Alaska Peninsula area.
I've spent quite a bit of time out sleeping in aircraft or underneath aircraft, waiting out weather. one of the things that I felt, frankly, was a mistake was the indoctrination of pilots to instrument techniques in receiving their private license. They give them a few hours of instruments. And I think one of the spin-offs of that has been the presumption on the part of the new pilot that he's capable of flying instruments, and therefore inclined to duck into weather that those of us some years ago with no instrument experience would have stayed out of it. Or, in my own case, I instructed instruments for a number of years, and the one thing that I have concluded from that experience has been that you stay out of instrument conditions in single-engine aircraft, and I don't buck it. I've got a lot of respect for the weather, and I've sat a lot of things out. And I think if there were one message I could convey, it would be that, to have a lot of respect for the weather, and for heaven's sake, when in doubt, don't.
In the final analysis, it's the FAA that's responsible for promoting small airplane safety, but Alaska's pilots are a notoriously independent-minded breed, and many of them chafe under the red tape and regulations imposed on them by the FAA. A number of pilots told us they had deliberately not reported fender bender type crashes simply because of the mind-boggling paperwork that is involved. Lyle Brown is head of the FAA in Alaska.
The United States has the best air transportation system in the world, without question. In fact, it's copied by all foreign countries, and even including Russia for that matter. So, and this was not brought about by accident. It was brought about through the work and effort of all the people. And I certainly think there has to be some regulations controlling an industry this size. So we must have done something right in the regulatory area. And I think the reporting of accidents is one of those regulations that if I were sitting on the other side of the fence with the general aviation pilot, I might object to also. But I think it serves a worthwhile purpose. We have been given considerable latitude up here, and it is somewhat different. And we're not requiring all of the red tape that is required elsewhere. So no, I don't like to see any more regulations than is absolutely necessary. We may have too many regulations now in certain areas, and they should be looked at and should be cleaned up.
Most pilots agree, however, that the FAA does serve a valuable purpose, and that on the whole, the agency is doing a good job, even though the pilots often had to be pressed to admit this. But everywhere we went, there was one specific complaint with the FAA in connection with safety, and it involves weather reporting stations.
And 10 years ago, we had manned stations in the outlying areas that was one of the key factors in getting current weather. And within the last 10 years, these has all been done away with, and they've automated some of these systems, and we have no longer the manned station with reliable weather reporting stations that we had 10 years ago.
And they've closed down a lot of the old FAA stations, primarily because of cost factors, and as a consequence, we don't get the visual observations, for example, we used to have in some of the remote areas, the passes and so forth. Persons living in the area taking weather observations used to convey directly to us. We have a lot of remote controlled equipment and a little less personalized touch.
But when you start to put a weather station in, let's say at the mouth of Rainy Pass, you're talking about almost building a community. You're talking about homes, you're talking about power, you're talking about sewer, water, the whole gamut, which is extremely expensive. The Weather Bureau has a limited budget for providing weather. And as you know, we have, as I say, a staff of 1,600 people, and with very little chance of getting additional personnel. So I can appreciate the weather problems, and I don't really see an answer to it at this point in time.
Is there really anything that can be done about improving Alaska's small plane safety record, considering the weather and the terrain, and Alaskans who use their planes like Jeeps? Frank Malone thinks so.
The private sector, private flying, is still the most dangerous of all the aviation activity involved. There's more fatals per 100,000 hours and pleasure flying than anything else. And the safest on the other end is the corporate pilot. They have the safest record. Now, there's got to be some reason. And when you sit down and analyze it, I think it all ends up to be one thing: management and training requirements. You know? We have too many pilots up here that come up here and learn to land on the sandbar the first time and become bush pilots. You know, this is when the man down south has only landed on 10,000 feet of concrete. So it's an educational process that we have to go through to try to, quote, unquote, improve the breed. And I think education is the whole secret, starting with the instructor from there on up. I talk to quite a few people at times, and I tell them that the aircraft on a ramp sitting by itself don't make too many mistakes, but when you put the pilot in it, if he really is not educated properly, it's easy for him to get in trouble.
Lyle Brown of the FAA is optimistic. He thinks that Alaska's pilots can and will improve their safety record. Some new training requirements have recently gone into effect, and Brown is considering more. But all the regulations in the world won't help unless the small minority of Alaska's pilots who do get themselves into trouble start using a little more common sense and caution and learn to recognize their limitations. Lyle Brown thinks they will. We hope he's right. Eric?
A report on supertankers and their impact when Alaska Review continues.